Unmute. Okay, good. Okay, all right. Hi. So, good evening. My name is John Shriver. I'm the CEO of NJPAC, and I want to thank everybody for joining Valerie Simpson, who's right over there, and me for an evening we are calling Valerie Simpson Music Mentors and Motown. And it is an hour that we are going to be blessed to spend with one of the world's most enduring and inspiring musical talents. You may look at this sort of beautiful background and say, where are you? And I will say we are at an undisclosed location. And it is the very glamorous home of Valerie Simpson. And thanks for welcoming
it's my pleasure okay. To have you here.
Thank you.
Are you ready to sing tonight too?
Absolutely not. I promise not. Now this is, see this? It looks like a martini, but it's actually a glass of water. But this is how elegant and glamorous the Simpson home is, okay? So before we continue, I wanna thank the sponsors of this and all our American Song programming at the Art Center, the Blanche and Irving Lurie Foundation, the David Steiner and Sylvia Steiner Charitable Trust, and the Joan and Alan Bildner Family Fund. And we are incredibly lucky that Valerie has agreed to talk about her music, her career, and most importantly, three women who were inspirational to you throughout your life. Valerie and her partner in life and music, Nick Ashford, first became famous in the 1960s. As songwriters and producers, Ashford and Simpson, first on their own, then at Motown, wrote a string of hit songs for the likes of Ray Charles, Chaka Khan, Aretha Franklin, Marvin Gaye, Gladys Knight, Smokey Robinson, and Diana Ross. You really couldn't get anybody, could you?
It was a hard job.
Songs like, and this is, they're part of the pantheon now, songs like Ain't No Mountain High Enough, I'm Every Woman, Ain't Nothing Like the Real Thing, Reach Out and Touch Somebody's Hand. They were hits when they were first recorded and now are part of the classic American songbook. In the 70s, Ashford and Simpson became known worldwide as recording artists, releasing more than a dozen albums. Their biggest hit, the 1984 smash Solid. And in the 90s, they opened the Sugar Bar in New York, a restaurant and club with a famous Thursday night open mic. Since Nick's early and untimely passing in 2011, Valerie has been writing, performing, and recording as a solo artist. And all along her journey, Valerie has met and befriended a slew of stars in the world of the arts. And she's going to share stories tonight about this life and three particular mentors, Maya Angelou, Nina Simone, and Cicely Tyson. Ladies and gentlemen, Valerie Simpson.
Ah, thank you, John. Mm-hmm. Your sweet voice. Yeah.
Thank you.
You know, that's one of those Motown songs.
Yeah.
That was the first song we ever produced. Nothing Like the Real Thing.
So tell us, go back a bit before we get to the ladies, right? And tell us how you and Nick met, and then tell us how the two of you got to Detroit.
Oh my goodness. Well, Nick had to leave Detroit to come to New York, to go back to Detroit, so that we could be discovered in Detroit. You know, life has its twists and turns, and you know, I'm fortunate because up until that point, I had no idea that I might be a songwriter. I knew I could play a piano, mm-hmm. but I didn't know I'd be able to write songs. So because he came to my church and we hit it off, I played the piano, he had lyrics, we just hit it off. It was just a natural thing. And I don't know if I would have ever been a songwriter had he not entered the church that day. You know, it was just meant to happen.
How has the church informed your music? I mean, I hear the church when you play the piano.
Yeah.
I hear gospel when I hear you sing. Tell me.
Well, you know, my grandmother was a minister, so I played in her church. Mm-hmm. And then I started singing with gospel groups. And there's such a feeling of freedom of singing gospel. I didn't consider myself a singer at the time, but I could sing, you know, but I wasn't one of those real singers at the time. But when you're in church, you have a freedom to do, it's all right because it's in the name of the Spirit. Okay. So you're allowed a lot of that, mm-hmm. you know, and I learned a lot and it still informs what I write. You know, I still find myself reaching for those chords and I like a big, you know, working part, you know, all the stuff I learned in church. I'm still using them tricks. They're wonderful.
That's so tell us how you got to Motown. You were two young kids and you were there. You meet Berry Gordy, who's an icon even then.
Yeah.
What was that like?
You know, Berry Gordy is unlike any music man I can think of because he is a songwriter. So you are intimidated by somebody who also not only runs the company, but writes great songs himself. So his word is law.
Mm.
And he wasn't that impressed because our first big hit was Let's Go Get Stoned. You know, so I mean, he was like, you know, we don't really need, you know, those kind of songs. We got acts like Diana Ross, Marvin Gaye, Temptations. They had everybody. So we went back to New York. I mean, we were a little hurt. So why'd you call us? Why'd you send us a ticket?
Right.
But that wasn't what he was looking for. He was looking for something deeper. So when we got to New York, we, as Dick would tell the story, we locked ourselves up. We knew this was a golden opportunity. And we locked ourselves in. We did the work. You know, some folks don't want to do the work. If you don't have it, you got to find it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we did. We worked hard, and then when we took our material back, you know, we had songs like "You All I Need to Get By." Ain't no Let's Go Get Stoned in that.
No, absolutely.
So, I mean, we were able to, and they had the best writers.
Yes.
So, you know, it was, you were in competition with the best.
Right.
They had the great writers, they had the great artists. You know, it was a songwriter's dream.
Did you know you were writing standards when you were in your 20s?
Oh.
I mean, and you were, right? I mean, no.
Well, you know, that's another, you know, my hat's off to Barry again.
Yeah.
For recognizing that these songs had legs,
mm-hmm.
they could last.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we was writing for a 2-month hit on the charts with a check to follow. That's what we were hoping for.
Right.
But he was seeing a future. He was seeing standards. He was seeing that if he got the songs re-recorded by somebody else in label, that song would have longevity.
Mm-hmm.
So we were very, very fortunate that his vision was much broader than ours.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And talk to us about how the the recording artists, the stars who did your tunes and your songs. How did they get, how did Barry choose them? Were you involved in that selection process? Did you have to sit with Ray Charles and, you know, audition a number for him? How did that work?
Oh, no. Well, Ray was before Motown, so I didn't ever, we didn't meet him until 20 years later.
Right.
But for the Motown artists, you know, our first hit there was Marvin and Tammy singing Ain't No Mountain High Enough.
Right.
And it was not produced by us. It was produced by Johnny Bristol and Harvey Fuqua.
Mm-hmm.
And so we sent our demo in. We knew that song was a hit. We knew that.
Mm-hmm.
So we sent them a good demo and they recorded it. And it did just what we wanted it to do. And so that opened that door. Then we had Your Precious Love with Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, Marvin Gaye, to his credit, had sung with many women. But he had a way of bringing out the best in the women that he sang with.
Mm-hmm.
He was very generous. Some, you know, some artists aren't.
Mm-hmm.
But he was very generous and he made everybody better. And he enjoyed a duet. So mm-hmm. we were fortunate, you know. And we would say, like, you know, having Marvin Gaye was just like having, you know, the icing on the cake, you know. And Tammy Terrell, too.
Mm-hmm.
It was just, we were just over the moon. We mm-hmm. were so lucky to start our careers at Motown mm-hmm. with the two of them.
So you're in the Songwriters Hall of Fame, right?
Yeah.
Of course, as you should be. Who are the songwriters who, not necessarily influenced you, because you're, what you create is unique to who you are as a creator and as an artist, but who are the songwriters who are meaningful to you?
Very much Burt Bacharach and Hal David.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I used to sing on some of their recordings for Dion. I sang backup.
Did you?
Because I had a blossoming background career until Nick told me, if you want to be a songwriter, you better stop doing all this extra stuff and sit down and do the work. So I stopped doing all of that. But I love the way Bert, his arrangements, how David's lyrics were just, I mean, a house is not a home, really.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Come on.
Right.
It was just, I mean, he was just the man, you know.
Uh-huh.
And also, you know, I loved Holland Dozier Hunt.
Yeah.
You know, the way their take on how to, you know, because Diana Ross and the Supremes didn't have it before they found that niche. They found out that Diana had that little baby voice, that she could do that little baby, baby. And they went to town with that,
right.
You know, and,
right.
and it worked.
Yeah.
And Nick used to say, you know, everything conforms to infancy. So that's how that worked.
Talk about Nick a little bit.
Oh, my goodness. Nick Ashford. Yeah. Wow, you know, what can you say except that was what I was supposed to do with my life. You know, everybody doesn't know what their path is going to be, but because we found each other and we could enhance each other, I knew that I was in the right place. That's why I could give up commercials, not knowing if I was going to ever have a hit song, but I trusted him enough and I trusted my gift enough to say, because, you know, there's no guarantee that you're going, anybody's going to ring your phone or that you're going to get a call or get the message to write for somebody. So we were always taking a chance. I always feel like, you know, I was living on the edge, but I wasn't scared. I just mm-hmm. knew that some kind of way I was doing the right thing
mm-hmm.
and I was putting in the time,
mm-hmm.
you know. Some people don't want to put in the time, you know, they'd rather go out and do other things. But we put in time. He said the sun came up and the sun went down, and it did. It
mm-hmm.
did. And we were still working on songs.
Mm-hmm.
Not sure whether they were great songs, but they got better. They did get better.
Mm-hmm.
And that competitive nature at Motown, you know, he would put us in rooms next to each other so you could hear what they were doing next door.
Oh,
and he went and looked at your thing again. He said, oh, that don't sound very good. I better go back.
Mm-hmm.
And work a little harder,
mm-hmm.
you know, so that really helped us along. It was like going to college.
Talk about the evolution of the two of you as songwriters, producers, to stars, to performers, to, how did that happen?
Rocky roads.
Yeah.
Rocky roads.
Yeah.
I mean, we were at Motown for 7 years and then we decided we wanted to, our contracts were up.
Right.
So we said, well, we did a soul show. And we got a lot of letters from that. Bless Ellis Haslip's heart. He recognized that we had some talent and he got a lot of letters So we said, well, maybe we should try the singing thing.
Mm-hmm.
But we were so nervous and so green and so not quite there yet. But, you know, it took some doing. Nick used to perspire, you know. He put towels under his arms before he hit the stage because he was so nervous, you know.
Yeah.
It was a hoot. But like anything else, if you do it long enough, you get better. And mm-hmm. we did get better. So I was happy when finally people started hearing our songs that we were singing and recognizing us, you know.
Because
mm-hmm. I didn't expect that.
Yeah, it's fascinating because by the time you were singing your songs live in front of audiences, they all knew the songs based on other performers making hits.
Yeah. Well, you know, when in doubt on stage, if you're a songwriter and you got other hit songs, use them. And that's what we did. We used the songs we wrote for other. We said, well, they'll say they can't be that bad if they wrote that. You know? And so they give you a little more grace.
Right. Anyway, yeah. so you, when we talked about doing this date, you said, I don't want to talk about myself. I want to talk about three women who were mentors to me and informed my life in major ways.
Yeah.
And they are, so tonight we can talk about Nina Simone and Maya Angelou and Cicely Tyson.
Yes.
Who just loved. So Nina was brilliantly talented. Famously complicated.
Very much so.
Right.
But that's the way I like my friends. You know, I don't like boring people. And she was not boring.
Never boring. So talk about your introduction to Nina. How did you become aware of her music and how did she become a part of your life?
Well, because of her piano playing and her great command, you know, she was a really gifted pianist.
Mm-hmm.
And she had a sound like no other. She didn't sound like all the other girl singers.
Mm-hmm.
She was a song interpreter. And I don't even know how we met, but I know we became fast friends,
mm-hmm.
which is hard to do with Nina Simone.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I remember, I don't know why I had the nerve to ask her to, we had a club called 2020. And I heard that she might be coming to town. And I asked, would she want to sing at this club that only held 250 people?
Mm.
For whatever reason, she said, yes.
Okay.
So we were flabbergasted. We won't get Nina Simone at a small club.
Mm-hmm.
Well, she said, but I have a few requests. I said, well, what might that be? She says, I know you have a Rolls Royce. Yeah. She says, I want to be picked up in the Rolls Royce. I said, okay, we'll arrange that. She said, and I said, well, we want you to stay at our home. She said, lovely. So I sent I sent two handsome guys. The driver was gorgeous.
Yeah.
Brad Johnson, who also managed the club, he was gorgeous. So I said, go pick up Nina Simone.
Okay.
I'll never forget, it was July.
Yes.
Nina Simone stepped off the plane in July with a white, full-length mink coat. And the guys act like that was the most natural thing in the world, and they brought her to my home.
Yes.
And it was fun sailing from that day on. Fun sailing.
So what was she like as a house guest?
She was demanding.
Yes.
She told my housekeeper of the time, she says, I want you to draw some water in the jacuzzi. I want you to hang up my clothes. I want some breakfast. And then the housekeeper looked at us and said, and what order would you like? It was her. Well, needless to say, she had a great run at the club.
Yeah.
But by the time it was over, my husband said to me, he says, call me when she leaves and I'll come back home. That was all he had to say.
So you and Nick visited her in the south of France in 2001.
Oh, that was another trip. Yeah.
We have a clip. You gave us a clip of that experience.
Oh, yes.
Can you set up the clip?
Well, we were down there to record a song that was going to be on an album of mine. And she had called me by chance for some material. So because she wanted material from us, I said, well, would you sing with me? And she said, yes. So therefore, we went to the south of France and stayed at her home. Mm. And that's what happened. And we did a little interview, which you'll see the clip of right now.
Okay, let's play it.
Hello, we're Ashford and Simpson.
And we're lucky enough to be in the south of France right now with Nina Simone. Oh, what a pleasure to be talking to you.
Merci.
I mean, we're talking to one of the greatest divas.
Of all time.
Of all time.
Absolutely. Do you mind us calling you diva?
Oh, no, I like it.
What is your connotation when we think of diva? How does that apply to you?
Well, I'm very much like Maria Callas. Uh-huh. Temperamental, short-tempered, disciplined, and very inclined to practice a great deal, though I don't like it.
Oh.
You know, that brings up the subject of why you're here in the south of France. Why did you pick the south of France to be?
Because it's sunshine and tranquility all the time, and I have a pool, and I have people around me who take care of me. Most of all, it's quiet, and it's my home now. Uh-huh. It's been like this for about almost a year, so we're still getting used to it.
Now, often when you do concerts in America, you know, we love you so much there. But you always seem to run from us. What is that with America that you can only spend so much time?
Now, darling, you should be, you shouldn't ask such a question.
No.
It's the racism.
Is it the racism?
Oh, yeah.
After all these years.
After all these years, it's racism.
We've made some progress.
Yeah, tell me.
Well, they long for you so much, though.
Your audiences are certainly a rainbow of colors. So people of every possible nationality love Nina Simone.
I appreciate that, but I still ran away from it because of that. And I stay away from it because of that. I haven't found this much changes in Alabama and Louisiana. I find it subtly still existing in New York and Washington and all over the states. It's in the very fabric of American ways. And I am very sensitive, more sensitive to it now than I was before. Because I know what it is not to be around it.
I see.
Wow.
Mm.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
She could have said that this morning.
Right. I was going to ask you.
Wow.
I wonder what Nina Simone would think about what's happening in this country now.
Everybody knows about Mississippi. Goddamn. She wrote that.
Right, she did.
You know, yeah. So, you know, some things haven't changed, and she's right. She's right. Mm.
So I am told that the last song that, is it the last song that she recorded was actually made for one of your albums?
Yeah. Isn't that amazing? We didn't know, you know, and I expected that, you know, she would be here much longer as she did because she was going to put out an album, you know, within the year. But, you know, life took a turn.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, that experience was quite the experience. And that's the thing that she would always give you is something different. I mean, she was the type of woman. She said to me once, she said, when are you going to send me that man? I said, what man? She said, Nick Ashby, you're not done with him yet? I mean, this is the front way she spoke to you, the very frank, up front, and I like that. Not somebody that's gonna stand behind your man and grab him and not say anything or wink at him. She wanted to know when. She was putting herself on the list to know when, and I can appreciate that. I had a good man, you know? And we laughed about it. I said, no, you have to wait on that.
Right, but she was serious. Right.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
So we have another clip, and it is you and and Nina performing Make It Up As We Go at the
Which
Sugar
is a
Bar.
Song that we went down there to do. We were down there with our engineer, Valerie Gent.
Yeah.
And she actually filmed that interview and did the engineering at the studio. So this is me in the Sugar Bar afterward singing my part to Nina singing her part, which you will hear.
Great, let's play it.
We had a wonderful time in the south of France with Nina Simone. It makes me laugh when I think about it because we sent her this song. And when she got the song, the lyrics seemed weird to her. As a matter of fact, she told Clifton that she thought that the lyric was saying that we wanted to have a menage a trois with her. So I said, let me look at this lyric again. Let me examine this lyric. Where did we go wrong? What I think it was trying to say was, sometimes in life, you just have to step out. You don't even know where you're going. But if you do it with spontaneity and a little even uncertainty, sometimes something great can happen. And I think that's kind of how we all want to do it from now on. We want it to be real, y'all. It don't have to be rehearsed no more. We just want to do it like Nina did it.
And we make it up as we go.
Make it up as we go.
There'd be no rules, no map to follow.
Don't draw me no map now.
And the tears would be real. Thrills would really thrill as we make it up as we go.
Interpreter.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There's such depth of emotion,
yeah.
Even more than when she was younger, mm-hmm. which is as affecting as ever, right?
Oh, absolutely, mm-hmm. absolutely. Mm-hmm. Any of those, there's so many great songs in her catalog, you know, some that she wrote, you know, for women. You know, it's just so moving, you know. And you know, her songs turn up in film a lot.
Really?
Oh yeah, they're in a lot of film, mm-hmm. a lot of films. Mm-hmm. Because people, there's something about that sound, you know. It's not like she's showing off her voice. It just is, you know, it's just this
thing. It's organic.
Yeah, so good.
All right, we're gonna, I wanna thank you, by the way, and this is 20 years ago, I booked a nightclub in New York called Feinstein's.
Oh, we had so much fun.
And we thought, you and Nick had, as far as I know, never played one of those.
No, we hadn't. That was our first.
That was a nightclub. And
it was right down the street.
And I remember we took you to lunch, and you were so nice, and you agreed to do it, which we shocked us, because you know, folks, that when Valerie and Nick would play arenas, they play stadiums, play concert halls, they don't play nightclubs. But this was a nice one.
Oh, it was great.
And the Tisch family.
Yes, were huge fans
of yours. And I remember I was so proud, because you agreed to do 2 weeks, and we were completely sold out for the 2 weeks.
It was a lovely, lovely, lovely engagement.
And I remember I talked to the older Tisch, I can't remember his name, John Tisch's dad, who was the Justin's Tisch. And I said, I was so proud of him, Mr. Tisch, we are sold out for 2 weeks. And he went, what happens on the third week? Who do you have after?
Oh my goodness.
Who comes after Epstein? That's awesome.
That's cute. Yeah,
that was pretty magical.
That was a fun time.
All right, so let's talk about Maya. Maya is best known to most of us as a poet, as a memoirist, but she was also an actress, dancer, singer, a filmmaker, a composer.
A director.
How did you guys meet?
Oh my goodness. I owe that to, actually it was Nick's keen eye spotting her on television.
Mm-hmm.
And he said he thought she was the sexiest thing in the world. And her laugh and the way she carried herself. And we knew that George Faison, the choreographer, mm-hmm. and our dear friend knew her,
mm-hmm.
and visited her. We begged for an invite. We said, please, you know, whatever you can do, we want to go and meet this woman.
Yeah.
So he did, and she allowed us to come to her home. I mean, she's so big-hearted.
Yeah.
And we went, and we had the best. She was like second family immediately. And she's just like one of the greatest joys. You have no idea of a person who can set a room on fire like Maya Angelou.
Yeah.
I mean, and by the time we started working together, if we did a gig, she would meet us at the hotel. She'd get there first and have the drinks all lined up at the bar, and she'd be sitting there waiting when we got there. We had everything was a party.
Yeah.
Everything was wonderful. She put people together who you could learn from and grow from. She would always put me and Cicely in a room next to each other, mm-hmm. so we could talk. That was after Nick passed.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, she was ever mindful of enriching mm-hmm. it and joy,
mm-hmm.
and good stories, you mm-hmm. know, and she was just the best.
So you collaborated.
Yes, we did.
Tell us about that.
Oh, well, one day, you know, she had a piano in the basement, and I went down in the basement, and I was sitting there playing, and she came on down, and I was just playing, you know, and she just started to recite some poetry. And Nick, you know, I think the first song was I Remember All. I can't even remember. Through my life is coming on. Sunny days. In the storm, little bit of this, little bit of that, I recall, when it comes to you, I remember all. And then she wrote this long little way on top of that,
mm-hmm.
and it was just beautiful. And we did some dates together.
Oh, you did dates together?
We did dates together.
Where would you play?
We played in New York on a Valentine's. I know, I remember, because we put her in a big Valentine and had her, you know, she was up for everything. That's what I love about Maya. She was up for anything, you know?
Yeah.
And then, you know, even when we would get parties in Connecticut, you know, and we'd have entertainment, she said, what can I do?
Right.
You know, and she would just, on the day up, on the spot, just be a part of everything. So I learned so much from being spontaneous. And also I learned that if somebody's in the room is not giving you love and you're trying to create, they need to exit, you know, because they're sending the wrong energy to you. And I never thought about that, you know, but she would say, would you please find something in the kitchen? You know, I mean, she was very clear about what it took to create, you know, and she didn't, you know, the muse, she didn't fool around with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you had to respect that.
So I want to play we have a clip of you performing the song that you wrote, I'm Every Woman, as a duet with Maya reading her poem, Phenomenal Woman.
That was one of the best afternoons. Yes.
How did it happen?
Well, I mean, you know, it was a natural, you know, I felt like those two songs went together, you know,
right.
And better that they be together than you get applause over here and I get over there, you know? And as I say, she was the kind of spirit. She danced. So when you see the clip of her up on stage, and this is a very short clip, I'm not gonna put the whole thing up because she just carries on.
Yeah.
You know, and she lifts things to another level, you know, and I love that. You know, certain people just have to bring the juice and the joy.
Yeah.
And she was one of those people.
All right, let's watch it.
Every woman, it's all in me. Anything you want done, baby, I do it naturally. I'm every woman, it's all in me. I can read your thoughts right now, if I want from A to Z.
Many, many people wonder where my secret lies. I'm not cute or built to suit a fashion model size. When I try to tell them, they think I'm telling lies. I say it's in the reach of my arms. It's in the span of my hips. It's in the stride of my step. It's in the curl of my lips. I'm a woman. Phenomenal. When I walk into a room just as cool as you please. And to a man, the fellows stand or fall down on their knees. And then they swarm around me, a hive of honeybees. Men themselves have wondered what they see in me. They try so much, but they can't touch my inner mystery. When I try to show them, they say they still can't see. I say, oh, it's in the arch of my back. Now, please understand just where my head's not bowed. I don't shout or jump about or have to talk too loud. When you see me walking, it ought to make you cry. I say it's in the click of my heels, the bend of my hair, the palms of my hands, the need for my care, because I'm a woman. That's you. It's there. Hey!
I'm proud,
cause I'm the one.
Just trust me.
Ooh, and it shall be done.
I got it.
Get it.
Ooh.
Wow.
Oh, such fun, such fun.
What did that feel like?
Oh, it was like over the moon. I mean, really, that was, I mean, I've enjoyed that song before, but never like that. Never mm-hmm. like that. You uh-huh. know, that, you know, that was just like piling on all the sugar, you know.
Right.
So great, so great.
Where were you playing?
We were playing in a place, I think we were in Philadelphia. It was in 1996. And we filmed the whole concert, actually. So I have a whole concert where, you know, she does other things.
Oh, wow.
We did a thing by
yeah.
ourselves.
Yeah,
yeah, so it was a joyous, joyous gig.
It would be
yeah.
great to release.
Yeah, we never really formally released it.
Yeah.
So I show it from time to time, little pieces here and there. But,
so you're a great friend. Mm-hmm. I think you're a great friend. What have you learned about friendship from Maya, from Nina, from Cicely Tyson?
Well, I learned that we all, I don't care how big you are and how far along in your career you are, we all are needy. We all have needs, and because we're always extending ourselves, sometimes those needs aren't met. So when you have somebody that you know you can call in your darkest hour,
mm-hmm.
if you have two people, that's very rare. And if you have three, that's almost unheard of,
right.
where you can tell them anything
mm-hmm.
and they will hear you out and hold you and carry you through that. That's what I learned about Rich.
Mm-hmm.
So I try to, aside from Maya being my mentor, I try to be that. Because, you know, as she progressed in age, some of her contemporaries passed away.
Mm-hmm.
So I knew she liked me, and I knew I could make her laugh, and I could make her, and she would listen to me too.
Mm-hmm.
For some reason or other, you know, she would consult me about certain things. So I knew we had a thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I was happy to be there for her, because when my husband Nick died, she got on her bus and came up here in bad weather
mm-hmm.
and held my hand. So mm-hmm. I mean, she was my friend. She mm-hmm. really was.
Mm-hmm.
I can't say enough about friendship with somebody like that. I mean,
mm-hmm.
really, truly.
Mm-hmm.
And she was a giver. I mean, she gave to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew that sometimes she needed somebody to fill that tank.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I tried to be there.
Well, she loved you,
mm-hmm.
and she loved your talent. I mean,
and she did have a great assistant, Lydia Stuckey.
Yeah.
My God.
Yeah.
Her associate, thank God for her, you know, and she continues to be a great, great friend of mine. Yeah.
So let's talk about Cicely.
Oh my.
Because those of us who live and work in New Jersey know a little bit about the work that she did as an arts educator in East Orange.
You wrote a beautiful piece about her. I learned so many things from the piece that you wrote about.
Well, I have to tell you that there's a wonderful arts educator in East Orange who works with us, whose name is Equa Colson. And Equa was our source for that story about Cicely, which we should stick in the chat if we can so
yeah.
people can see it. But when did you first meet Cicely?
I can't honestly say exactly when.
When did you become aware of her?
But I knew her even before her marriage to Miles.
Mm-hmm.
And Nick and I and she and Miles went on occasionally. We're out together. I mean, she's like many lots too.
Yeah, sure.
And that was some happy days. But the thing I like about her most is how she, I think she was the most concentrated in her work. She just knew her purpose, you know? And she was determined that these little scrubby parts they might try to give her wasn't happening, you know? You gotta be willing to wait for the real thing because you don't know if it's coming, but she was willing. And then she got wonderful parts that made us proud, that promoted us as women. And she used to come to the parties, and she didn't like to take pictures, but she didn't like you to photograph her, but she would photograph you. think when she did the trip to Bountiful.
Right. It was in her 90s.
In her 90s.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I remember going to the show.
Yeah.
And after it was over, I was astounded. I was like, how could she stay out there on the stage that long? Longer than anybody. Singing, dancing, and all these lines to remember. When I went backstage, I said, show me your hand. She said, why? I said, show me your hand. I thought she had the lyrics, the lines.
Yeah.
I said, you mean it's not on the stage? You're remembering all of this stuff in your 90s? This is crazy.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. And then I was told that everybody else in the cast would miss a day or two. Cicely never missed a day. Mm-hmm. I mean, so dedicated. And then, when I got the call that she had passed, it was hard. I had to come from West Palm Beach and I had just had my second shot.
Yeah.
But I was determined, I was not going to miss this.
Mm-hmm.
And B. Michael and Mark Anthony had put the whole thing together.
Mm-hmm.
And I got in the morning. And I had a little thing. And I said, sometimes, when you're surrounded by greatness, if you're lucky enough to be under that umbrella, you don't even know that you're breathing in rarefied air. I wish I had two more ears. One more eyes, maybe. To grasp all the lessons to be learned from one who's living life to the fullest. That's the way Cicely did it, to the fullest. I mean, over the top. I must say, I never even considered age when I was around her. Just to be in the presence of this giant, because she defied conventional wisdom about what each decade should represent. And then there was this green juice she used to drink. I don't know what was in that stuff. I should have found out. But she just kept going forward. So when I viewed her, I saw an ever-present, you know, my buddy, B. Michael, was her ace friend.
Mm-hmm.
He and his partner, Mark Anthony.
Mm-hmm.
He designed all those beautiful clouds.
Yeah.
All that radiance. And then there was Armand Hambrick, who did the makeup and the hair. And anytime she presented herself, she was a vision.
Mm-hmm.
She was a vision.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, she was on the cover of Time. She was the vision, you know? She redefined the decades. We can no longer think of what 70 and 80 should look like because it's not so. It's right. Not so. Cicely mm-hmm. said,
yeah.
It's not so.
Mm-hmm.
She just kept on mm-hmm. keeping on. I love her so much.
Yeah. You were at the opening of the opening night of the Cicely Tyson School.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, you know, to be quite honest, I didn't know that you could be alive and have a school named after you. I didn't. I thought you had to pass away.
Yeah.
But if they changed the rule, they needed to.
Yeah.
Because look how much she was able to do for that school. I mean, you know, some people take an honor like that. You see them that one day, and you don't hear from them no more.
Mm-hmm.
But she was there through so much. Those children used to come to her plays. She made sure they had tickets. They went on trips with Cicely. She spoke for them, as you well wrote in your article. Mm-hmm. You know, she took it personally. These are my children. I am going to point them in the direction.
That's right. Yeah.
I miss her so much. Yeah.
So I imagine a bunch of our kids, our arts ed kids from Newark and Greater Newark are listening in, watching tonight. These are young musicians, young dancers, young singers, young poets.
Yeah.
Give them some advice, please.
Well, all you can be is your authentic self. Everybody can have a gift. But you gotta dig down deep enough. It's not on the top layer. You gotta sit there a while. You gotta stew in it. Mm-hmm. And then see what you come up with. And then maybe throw that out. And some people get hung up on what first happened. You know, that may not be the final say on the thing.
Mm-hmm.
So if you feel like you really have a talent, you can test that talent. Put it to the test. You can always go back for something that you did. But if there's something to come and you didn't reach for it, then you didn't get it. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a lot of folks who will be copying, who study others. But if there's a muse in the room, I want it to land on me. You know what I mean? So I'm not going to be listening to what somebody else is doing. That's if you got a gift.
Mm-hmm.
That's my thought.
That's a good thought. That's a good thought. And you know, I would say, to follow on what you just said, you got to trust your own voice.
Yeah.
You have to have confidence and give yourself confidence in your voice.
Yes.
Because what you have to say is important.
Right. You know, I never wrote a song before, so
right.
But I had to try.
Yeah.
And the first ones weren't that good, you know, but I kept trying. Yeah. I liked it and I kept trying and I kept getting better. Yeah. So, you know, sticking in there is the key.
Mm-hmm. So we amazingly we're just at the hour, but it would be beautiful if you would finish our hour with a song you love by you.
No. Yeah. It's so much fun talking to you, John. We haven't done this in a long time. Talk. No.
Nothing's gonna keep me.
Inspirations in your life, and how they inform who you are. It's
and I didn't mention my two daughters who just keep me going.
Wait a minute,
Asia. Cole. I did not mention them.
Yep.
You know.
Yeah.
Not only did I have a great husband.
Asia produced the show.
Yes, right. Great mom.
Wait a minute, Asia.
I got tears in my eyes. I don't know.
Sorry. So it takes a family. It takes your whole family to pull all this stuff off. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We've kept that sugar bar going all through this pandemic. And
so talk about that.
So, you know, I'm really glad about that because we've gathered new friends from around the world going virtual every Thursday. And so people who never made it through the doors are coming into the sugar bar.
Mm-hmm.
And I can say that is the one thing that is the thread between Nina Simone, Maya Angelou, and Cicely Tyson. All were patrons of the Sugar Bar and loved it. And we loved having you.
Yeah.
Well,
we are close to rescheduling. The Sugar Bar was going to come to New York.
Right, we were coming, yes.
And then that pandemic hit.
Sure did. With Dave Koz, you know, and he's already called. When are we going to do the date? I'm like, okay, we're going to do the date. Yeah.
Put the date on the books. How do people tune in on Thursdays for Sugar Bar?
On Facebook, Astrid Simpson Sugar Bar at 8 o'clock.
Great.
Yeah, so Thursday just look us up. There we'll be.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'm there every Thursday with bells.
Great. You're beautiful. You're a beautiful person, my friend.
You really are.
And I promise you, we will do that one person. We will get that one person show together, right? Because you did one tonight.
No.
So let me tell you guys that I want you to join us again next Thursday, May 27th at 7, and we will have a sextet of amazing jazz musicians with us, 5 past winners of our Sarah Vaughan International Jazz Vocal Competition, and they will join our jazz advisor, the great Christian McBride, for a conversation about jazz, the music business, about how their careers have advanced in some really remarkable ways since they last came to see us. And they include Cyril Ami, who's a wonderful singer, Jasmia Horn, who's now a 2-time Grammy Award nominee, as well as Kiana Linnell, Lauren Talese, and our last swinger, Samara McClendon. You can find links to register for this and all of our virtual events at injuredpec.org. God bless Valerie Simpson.
Thanks, thank you, Eddie.
And we will see you around. Take care, everybody.
Bye-bye. Good night.
Hello, friends. I'm Lear DeBessene, the Artistic Director of Encores at New York City Center, and welcome to Inside the Revival.
Is this supposed to be video?
Yes.
Let me just put some color under these eyes. I'll be back in 5 minutes.
Okay. Yeah.
We're talking about the life, right? When I was a teenager, I came into town and one of the auditions was for the life, but my baby face revealed me. A couple of years later, I'm out of school. Backers auditionings were happening for the life. And Joe Layton calls me, Fleetwood. The Backers auditions were just four people. Queen, Pam Isaac, Sonya, Lilia's wife, Memphis, Chuck Cooper, and me, Fleetwood. Joe Layton died, and I never heard from anybody again. So then you call me in February of 2020, and I said, I would need to have access to do whatever I wanted.
That was what you required, and that's what the estate said. You have free reign to do your revival.
The music is brilliant. The music is genius. The thing that stuck out to me the most was this fact that, like, it's white people writing about black people. Now, I have to say this. The life is the bridge between musical comedy and musical drama. I feel, in retrospect, that needed to be a drama. The creatives who were in charge didn't know how to tell that story. That's all. I really want to say that enough because I want to honor our allies. I want to honor the people who I worked with. They saw us, but the business was not ready for our stories at that time to be told from us. Ooh. And the first question I asked myself was, why are we telling this story?
Yeah.
Well, it serves the purpose to show the disparity in our system in America.
I know that, you know, one of the things that you really wanted to do was center blackness in this production, right? In this reinterpretation. Where do you want to take JoJo? In what
My
direction?
Aesthetic is hope. It can go to the depths of hell. But ultimately, the glimmer of hope is where I personally need to land in my work. So with JoJo, I thought, he is the manipulator. He also breaks the fourth wall and talks to the audience. If I can connect him to success, then everything else will fall into place. So I started with JoJo. He gets out.
You gotta use every friend as means to an end. Ain't that what a friend is for? You gotta use what you got to get what you want. So take my advice from this moment on.
So we've asked Michael Kilgore to interpret Use What You Got. With Michael's qualities, what are you trying to examine?
We in the theater have put such limitations on what black excellence means. You want us in the room, but then you want to put chains on us. I'm taking the chains off of all these people.
To get everything that you want before what you got.
unique position to understand how to get him there so that the world can see Black excellence.
What you got is gone.
Why are these people, these tragic figures, singing like heroes?
Well, how can you create empathy for professions that are so vilified? And I said, the only way to create empathy is to have no choice.
Mm.
Everybody in that show is trying to hustle to get somewhere else. They don't want to be prostitutes. They don't want to be pimps. They don't want to be drug addicts. They would love to be able to get somewhere else. That is what I've imbued in everything in this show. Is the somewhere, is the hope. So that's where we start with the life. You know, and with Ledisi, it's the same thing. The Broadway community is not ready for Ledisi because she doesn't have a filter. She doesn't have a theater filter.
I am worn out and weary. I ain't no machine. My head hurts, my feet hurts, and everything in between. I'm getting too old by the oldest profession. I'm getting too tired and too slow.
When I was in drama school at Carnegie Mellon and I couldn't understand the acting thing because I was a singer first and then a dancer second, my teacher, Tony McKay, he said, Billy, whatever it is that you're channeling when you sing that Jesus music is what I'm talking about in this class. If you can find a way to connect to talking in the way that you sing, you'll be fine. You'll be amazing. That is Ledisi.
Yes.
To tell you the truth, I've had so many.
I am so excited to get in a room with her and to have Broadway audiences receive that.
Love these conversations because this is exactly what Encores is about. Like, how can we broaden the embrace of the American musical theater tradition?
When we know better, we do better. And now it's time for those of us who's in a position of power to call that shit out. That's what it was. And here's how we fix it. I'll show you how. This is what it looks like.
For the love.
Jokers always want, and when they get it, we don't see them.